Getting a simple 2D player to move is more tweaking than you could expect for such a basic functionality inside a game engine. But it's also a great opportunity to learn how to handle inputs and rigid bodies. This episode focuses on a technique with the new input system to get your character move with very less code. In the next part, we will look at animations by using sprite sheets. This tutorial is meant for beginners, though I recommend you to have watched at least a Unity basic tutorial explaining the UI and how you use an IDE to write scripts. I start with a new 2D project. I am using the most recent stable version, 2021.2.12. Be aware that there might be changes when you use other versions. And if you are confused because my layout looks different than yours, I made a short video about it. I just absolutely can't stand the default layout. But at the top of the panels you can see their name and should be able to find the panels I talk about. I will start with a simple tile map. Everything I've done here will be explained in my tile maps tutorial. I also topic colliders because this will get interesting with a player, but this won't be part of this episode. I just downloaded a simple character sprite sheet of this half-naked dude. The sprite sheet contains not only the player, but a lot of animations. By simply changing the shown sprite, you can easily create animations. This is especially often done in pixel art. So we will focus on this kind of 2D animation, but this will happen in the second part. Drag and drop the sprite sheet into your sprites folder. Now we can change the settings. Obviously, it will be of type multiple, like we also know from the tileset. For this specific sheet, the pixels per unit are 16. To get pixel art nice and crisp, I also change the folder mode and the compression, and then save it. Now open the sprite editor. Now we can slice the image into several ones. From the site I downloaded it, it says the size is 16 by 18. So I slice it with grid by cell size and enter 16 for X, and the Y axis is with 18 slightly taller. After clicking apply, I now have all those single sprites created. But I want to change something. To make sorting better, I will change the pivot point you can see in the center of the sprites to the bottom. You can do this individually or for all at the same time by going to slice again. And here, I can change the pivot to bottom. When hitting apply again, the pivot point now changed. For pixel art, also set the pivot unit mode to pixels. This will then change for all the sprites in this sheet. Now let's see. Looks like number 22 is the default front standing position. Let's remember this and close the sprite editor after applying all the changes. You can see that you now have all those individual sprites. Let's just take the 22 and drag it right into the scene. Due to the pixel size we set, 16, and which matches with the pixel size of the environment, the size of the character fits nicely. Taking a look, this created a simple object containing a sprite renderer with the sprite already selected. You could also achieve this by creating an empty game object and adding the sprite renderer on your own. But of course, this was easier. Let's start with the movement part. As mentioned, we want to use Unity's new input system. I already covered this topic in 3 videos. I showed different approaches in all of those. But for this video, we will use the approach from video 1, which is the easiest with the least amount of code, which makes it really beginner friendly. So let's start by installing the new input system. Go to Window, Package Manager and select Unity Registry here. Here look for Input System and then click on Install. During the installation process, Unity wants to restart. For this, confirm this dialog. When it's installed, we can define our controls. For this, create a new folder called Inputs. Now right-click, Create, and at the bottom you should see Input Actions. Otherwise, check your installation and restart Unity. I call it Player Inputs. Here we need to add an action map. You can have several maps using the same keys differently. for the sake of your user, this should be reasonable, like one for the game and one for the UI or the menu. So I name mine in-game and then get rid of this default action. The actions are what should be achieved when using keys. So of course we want movement. So click at the plus and name it movement. We now have this default binding for one single button. But as movement is not just one button, we can achieve much better results by using Unity's axis system. Taking a look at a second plus, we have an option for positive-negative binding. This would be used for a side-scroller, where you can only move left and right, so one axis. But we want a movement on two axes. Click at the movement and change the action type to value. Here we can change the control type to vector2. Clicking at the plus again, we now have an option which basically looks like movement. Use this up-down-left-right composite. I call it WASD because those are the buttons I am going to assign to their corresponding direction now. By clicking on listen, you can just type the key and it should be selectable. Now you can add keys that should represent the exact same behavior, so other movement options like the arrow keys or a controller stick. The latter one is a simple binding like this. So when done, click the Save Asset button here. Now we have our movement action. Let's get back to the player sprite. I start by renaming. We are going to move the player by physics by using a Rigidbody 2D. This is not necessary, but a simple way to achieve movement and collisions. So add a new component, Rigidbody 2D. Since we want a 2-axis movement, we want to move up and down. For this, we need to set the gravity scale to 0, otherwise your player would fall out from the map, like in a side-scroller. Now your player will stay at its position. But not the target we want to achieve. Add another new component, player input. In the first slot, link the file we just created. Drag and drop it or select it via the dialog. The first action map is selected by default. For me, this is the only one, and of course the one containing the movement, so that should be selected. That's it for those settings. Time for our first script. But at first, I need a scripts folder, of course. This script will be responsible for the movement of the player, so that's why I name it player movement. Open it with a double click. Per default, this should open in Visual Studio, which you should have installed together with Unity. I am using Visual Studio Code. That's a different IDE, but don't worry, we will only edit code, so in theory, you could also do this in something like Notepad, though I don't recommend it. I delete the start and update methods. At first, we need to import the package for the new input system. This is necessary every time you want to code with references to this package. Add using UnityEngine.InputSystem at the top to your imports. Now we can create a method with a specific name that then will be called automatically when one of our actions gets triggered. So the movement action gets triggered when using one of the referenced buttons. And since this action is named movement, we will name our method onMovement. Be careful to name everything correctly according to your action. Since this is more than a yes or no button, we want Unity to also give us the information which axis, which direction, is being pressed. For this, we add a parameter in the brackets here of type inputValue and name it value. Obtaining the input is done in this method, but the actual movement will not happen here. To always have the most recent input value, we are going to create a class scoped variable. This means the variable will be declared at the top of the class. It is private, from type vector2, and has the name movement. Declaring means just telling the compiler that there is this variable, but it does not have a value right now. And now all methods in this class can read or change this variable. But now, whenever we change the input, either by pressing or releasing one of our defined keys, we want to save the corresponding vector2 in this variable. So movement will get the value from the right side of the equal sign. And to extract the vector 2 from the generic input value we'll receive as parameter, you just have to write this. The get method from the value will get the actual value and will tell the compiler that this is of type vector 2. Back in Unity, drag and drop the newly created script onto your player object. You can see it here in the inspector. When starting the game, obviously nothing will happen when pressing the movement keys. But by clicking at these three little dots in the inspector, I can select debug. This will expose private variables in the inspector, or at least those that can be shown somehow. Now you should see the movement variable we defined. Click in the game to focus it, and when now pressing WASD, the vector gets updated. A is negative 1 for X, and D positive. W is positive Y, and S negative 1. Pressing two directions at the same time will of course affect both axes. It is by default normalized, and therefore the strange 0.7 number. This will prevent your player from walking faster diagonally. All we need to do now is to connect those directions with the Rigidbody and tell it to move. Back in your code, add a new variable of type Rigidbody2D. I name it simply RB. Currently this variable is empty, but fortunately the game object of the Rigidbody is the same of this script, the player. So in the default awake method of this mono behavior, we can assign the value of this Rigidbody variable to the existing Rigidbody2D from the game object where the script is located. This is done with the getComponent method. This will look for the component whose type is defined between the angle brackets. This must match the type of the variable at the game object of this script. For performance, you should call methods like this only once in your awake or start method and save the result in a variable, which you then can access in your update loop. Speaking of the update loop, you might already came across this. This method called update is called once every frame for every mono behavior. This is where you can place your game logic that should get executed every frame. But when it comes to physics-based movement, our Rigidbody, there is a better one. It's called fixed update, and does not exactly happen once every frame, but similar. It's frame rate independent, and has a frequency you can define for your project. This call happens once every fixed frame rate frame. Let's keep it simple. If you know something is physics-based, and this is applied for everything Rigidbody related, put it in your fixed update. To the movement. You have several arrays to move your Rigidbody. A Rigidbody2D has a movePosition method, which takes a position the Rigidbody should move to this fixed frame. So you have to calculate a position by using its current position plus the direction you want to move in. Since our movements are usually a value of 1, that would be way too fast for one frame. So we multiply it by time.fixDeltaTime. In a normal update loop, you would use time.deltaTime. But remember that the fixed update has a different frame rate, so be careful to use the correct delta time. This will only add a little bit of direction to the current position. But this will happen every fixed frame, and so the object looks like it moves. Save and switch back to Unity. We can now test this. Your player should now move. Otherwise, please go back and check everything again. But let's check out the other mentioned methods. And also add the variable for more speed. Actually, let's start with the speed. If we want the player to move faster, the calculated value here must be higher. So this could be done by just multiplying it with 5, for example. But adding a random number in here is not good practice, because you usually forget why this number is here. So saving the number in a variable with a name helps you to know what it is for. But there is also no need for saving the number 5 in this integer variable every fixed update. We will only instantiate it once at the top of our class. And it would even be cooler if we were able to adjust the number directly from Unity. You know, for tweaking and inspecting. It is private, so definitely not visible in Unity, except you are in debug mode, like what we did with the movement vector. But this is not editable. We could make it public, but it is never recommended to use public methods or variables unless you know you have to. So Unity gives us an option for showing and editing private variables in its inspector. Just add serialize field in front or above your variable and that's it. The 5 is now the default value, but it can be overwritten in the Unity inspector. In play mode, your player should now move faster. And you can just change the value and the movement speed reflects this instantly. But those changes in play mode are not saved when leaving. So remember your number, leave play mode and then update the value. Now to the second option, the rigid body's velocity. Just comment out the first line so that we can safely test the other movement. When a rigid body has a velocity applied, it moves in this direction. This is the more physics-based behavior compared to the move position method. This value is set when applying a force to a rigid body, but you can also set it directly. This is what I want to do. It is represented in a vector 2, just like our movement. Also, don't forget to multiply it with the speed. It's ready to be tested. When pressing a button, the player moves just like before. Well, so why use this, besides being less code? So currently our movement is completely abrupt. The player starts with 100% movement speed and stops at a fraction of time. In a platformer, this would be boring as hell. And also, shortly tapping your W key is not a slower movement, but that would be much cooler. The main problem we currently face is this onMovement method also gets called when releasing the button. Sure, otherwise we wouldn't stop. But setting the velocity to 0 stops the player instantly. So that makes sense. Let's add an if statement which prevents to set the velocity if x and y are 0. So if one of those values is not 0, then we can change the velocity. When testing, well, the player won't stop. This is because there is no friction, no linear drag. Increasing this number should make your player stop. The higher the number, the faster he will stop. And you can also now see this little sliding on stopping. For more details, check out my video about this topic. It's just 2 minutes. Well, but this did not improve our start. You know, short tipping on the keys should be short movements. Of course, because we set the velocity right at the start to its maximum target value. That's why it is recommended to use forces to set the velocity. Let's try this. Comment out the other code. Now we can use the AddForce method of the rigid body. This also takes a vector 2 as parameter and we multiply it with the speed. For this to work properly, you have to adjust your speed to a higher value. Just play with the linear drag and the speed until you like the movement. Now, it really depends on the type of game you're coding to decide what movement method you want to use. In my opinion, for a top-down game like this, the first method with the stiff movement feels best. But if your player should slide on ice, you now know different methods for this as well. Now our player moves, but he always looks the same. How to change the direction he looks in and how to animate a walking behavior will be done in the next episode. Thank you for watching, and also thank you to everyone supporting me and the channel. Special thanks to my supporters on Patreon, Patrick, Naxwomo, Bastion Librarian and Ellie. Thank you all. And as usual, if you enjoy the content, consider liking and subscribing, and I'll see you next time.